Welcome to our community. Susie Thomas with you this morning. We spoke with Kim Thompson from the Better Business Bureau, and we did not even scratch the surface. So we said, you must come back and help us, help protect us. Good morning, Kim.
Good morning again, and thank you for having me back, because you're right. There is just, unfortunately, so much that we can talk about in order to educate ourselves to try to keep those scammers at arm's length.
That's right. Well, we needed a part two for sure. First of all, let's just give general information for anybody who might have missed it. The Better Business Bureau, what you do and what the Better Business Bureau does and what you specifically do for them.
So Better Business Bureau, usually when people hear Better Business Bureau, they think of businesses. Mm-hmm. So typically, people know that if I am about to hire a roofer or a contractor, they know that they can look up BBB.org and check out different roofers or contractors or, a business to see, if they have complaints brought against them or if now we have customer reviews. And so they can read what other people have said about those companies.
Compare something like that with Yelp. How's it different?
So it's, some of it's the same.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Because mm-hmm. it's still consumers. It's a way for consumers to tell other consumers about their interactions.
Mm-hmm.
So, but with us, we can kind of go a step further. So with our complaints, what it is it's, that consumer has had an interaction with that business, but they need something still from that company. So it's either I've had this interaction and I need them to come back out and finish what they've started, or I'm asking them to come out and maybe it was they removed a tree from my yard. But with our contract, they were supposed to take the stump and it's still here. So my complaint is they didn't take that stump. I need them to come back and get that stump. So that's why it's a complaint, because I still need something from them. But a customer review, they've had an interaction with that company. I don't need anything though. I'm simply wanting to tell others about my interaction,
yes.
Good, bad, or indifferent. So that's why it's a little different as far as BBB goes, because we offer two different avenues for people to get that information out to others.
Also, I'm wondering,
to tell others. Yeah.
Yes. You've been around for so, not you individually, you haven't been around that long, but the Better Business Bureau has been around for some time, that it's sort of the granddaddy of, this kind of service, and we kind of feel like we can trust you. Do you have ways of being able to know whether customer reviews or complaints are on the level, or if this, and to make sure it's not just a competitor trying to say something disparaging about the competition?
Absolutely. Because when they come in, we actually verify them.
Mm-hmm.
So we are not just taking it at, at someone's word. We are going to verify that they actually were a customer. And like you said, not a competitor, just trying to get ahead or something. So everything is verified before we put it out there. And we do have some come in that are not able to be verified. And so we do not post it out there on BBB.org. So, because unfortunately, not everybody is ethical in the world.
Yeah.
So, and we have in fact found competitors doing exactly what you just said. And so those will not be posted out there. So anything that's posted out there, we have in fact verified. So we do have systems in place, because we do know that not everybody is ethical out there.
Unfortunately.
And we just had a survey come out, and I just clicked on it so I could look at it closer so I could see it.
Mm-hmm.
It was put out, 2001 Americans were surveyed, and they were ranking BBB, our surveys, Google reviews, when you look in and you say as seen on TV.
Yeah.
And when you're looking and it says featured on Forbes, Yelp reviews, 5-star ratings on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
And if you see that something was ranked on Inc. 5000.
Mm-hmm.
And for those 2,000 Americans that were surveyed, when Americans see something has an A-plus rated on the BBB, it was 27.6% stated that that meant more to them than any of those other items that I mm-hmm. listed. 5-star rating on Google reviews was 24%. And then it goes down from there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that just came out this week to where consumers are, like you said, BBB has been around for a very long time. And it means something to Americans is what we're, you know, finding that, you know, 27% said that, you know, seeing yes. that they're A-plus rated on the BBB, you know,
that carried
means
more
something
weight.
More than, yeah, those Google reviews mm-hmm. or as seen on TV or the Yelp reviews. So we are very, very proud of that.
Yes, absolutely. And it's the credibility right there. So, and a good reminder to us that when we're wondering about a company, that's where to go. Go to the BBB, and it's BBB.org. Couldn't be right. easier to find you. You in particular, you have kind of a really fun job. You're kind of like the Columbo of the BBB. You get to find out who's not being ethical here.
I get kept on my toes. I do quite a few different things. You know, it's like, what hat do I have on now?
Yes.
So, you know, yes, I'm the investigator of the office. So when we do find that little man that's not being,
yeah.
you know, the straight shooter or whatever, you know, the scam artist that is using an address of maybe it's a business that has shut down. It could be even a made up address.
Yes.
And he's gone online and just made up a website, but he's going and made up a website that with a fake web, you know, address, or he's borrowed an actual company's website. We actually have this poor couple. There's an actual couple in West Virginia where it's where they live, and they've lived there for like 50 years, and they're just the nicest little couple. And this poor, these people, they're actually from overseas. They are using their address, and I think I am now up to about 10 different websites that I have uncovered that they are using this actual couple's address.
Their home address.
Yes, their home address. So they are being bombarded with letters from consumers that are being taken because the websites that they're creating are selling products.
Oh my.
So people are going on, not doing their due diligence and, you know, seeing because there's not good contact information. Like if you do any research on these websites, any amount of research at all, you'll start realizing that things don't add up. But we as Americans do so much online shopping that we just take things for granted that,
yes.
hey, there's a website here and there's
yes.
a nice picture of this item I want. And we just click, 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 buy, you know? So
where would they have gotten their address? Just dumb luck? They just kind of threw an arrow out there?
And you know what? I actually don't have that answer.
Oh,
I don't.
My.
I have tried to get their site uh-huh. shut down. I have tried several different things so far to no avail because unfortunately like I've said before, scammers are very smart people.
Yes.
They know what they're doing.
Yes.
So, but yeah, we're now up to about 10 different sites. They just keep moving on and opening up a new one. And then the websites are very similar. They're selling the same type of products. And this poor couple, they just keep getting these letters of people complaining that they're not getting their products and they're not getting their return because the emails then stop working that are all the customer service emails that they have
right.
on the website.
Right.
So in that case, the scam artists are using a real address of real live people. They don't always, sometimes it's a fake address of, it's just made up. It doesn't even exist. Sometimes it's a real one of an actual company. How the scammer decides what address they want to use, who knows? I've seen investigations where they've actually gone on and taken an actual company's website copied it almost completely. Wow. They've actually copied the pictures of their staff, but they'll change the names, but they'll use the same, like if it's the CEO, it's the CEO of the scam company, but they've changed the name, but it's the same picture.
Oh my goodness.
I mean, it's crazy. The
That's bold.
That
That's really bold.
It is. So, you know, there's a way that you can go in and look for Google images and see if that image of the website that you're looking at is elsewhere on the internet.
Oh, that's brilliant.
That's how I find the other websites that are out there.
That is so smart.
Yeah.
At least the couple did the right thing and contacted you. I mean, what else are they to do? They did the right thing. They contacted the Better Business Bureau. You mentioned.
And they also contacted their police, their local police,
good.
To let them know.
Good.
I mean, they did. Unfortunately, they had to do all that.
Yeah.
You know, it's sad that they had to, but they put some letters out there to try to cover their bases so that nothing was coming back on them. But it's just very sad what these scammers do.
You mentioned online shopping. I do quite a bit of that as well. I always feel kind of safe if I see that lock. I always look for the little lock. Am I safe to shop when there's a lock on type at the very top? Or are these scammers so smart that they're able to even make something look secured with a lock?
Mm-hmm. That's a start. So you definitely want to start by looking for that lock, but don't stop there. Keep doing other homework on that website and make sure that you don't see other red flags on that website. But yes, you definitely want to make sure that you have the lock, because if you don't have the lock, stop everything, you know, and don't proceed with that website.
Right.
But if you see the lock, please don't think, oh, I must be okay, because you are correct. The scammers, like with the IRS scam that was going on, as soon as they caught on with, you know, so consumers know that, you know, we are doing this, so we're going to fix it and, you know, not make that, you know, we're catching on. They catch on with what we learn and they fix it. So we have to keep trying to educate and get smart, because they're smart people and, you know what I mean? Like, they keep evolving, so to speak.
Yeah.
So you're right. They're going to be able to make it look like it's secure and safe.
Yikes.
So we don't want to just stop there. We want to keep checking out that website.
You said IRS scam. You said IRS scam as if I know what you're talking about. So please tell me, what was the IRS scam?
So the IRS scam is where they're calling on consumers and saying that they are with the IRS, which right there is the first red flag. The IRS is not actually calling any consumers.
Okay, the IRS doesn't call.
Because I always tell people,
okay.
Yeah, well, government entities do not call consumers. Because I always tell consumers, I say, well, think about it. The government doesn't have enough staff to be calling us. They just don't. So they send letters out. So that's our first red flag. They're not calling you.
But you get nervous. You get a phone call from someone saying, hi, I'm from the IRS. That's got my attention. And right away, I'm feeling like I've gotten sent to the principal's office.
Exactly. And that is why they're doing it. That's why the government grant scam gets so much headway. Mm-hmm. Because it's the exact same thing. Oh, well, if the government wants to give me money, then all right, I want to take it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So that's exactly why they do it. And that is what the premise is, because like you said, I'm paying attention now. They've got my attention because I'm afraid, you know, and that's your emotions. So they got your emotions heightened. So now we're not really thinking, you know, with our brain.
Yeah.
Now it's more we're reacting. And that's exactly how scammers get away with what they get away with, because they've got us reacting, not thinking.
Okay, you get a call from the IRS. It's not the IRS. We know that. All right.
Right.
This always goes so fast. All right, I need to take a short break, and we will be back with Kim Thompson from the Better Business Bureau after these words. You're listening to Our Community. Welcome back to Our Community. Susie Thomas visiting with Kim Thompson from the Better Business Bureau. This woman is your next best friend, because you listen to what she has to say. She's going to keep you from getting taken. There was one we talked about last week, Kim, that I think was so important. It bears repeating. A grandparent scam or emergency scam. This one is so easy to fall for because our emotions are heightened. And I want you to repeat it just in case anyone missed it.
Okay. So The main way that they do it is a phone call, and they're usually targeting somebody that would be of age to have grandkids, where they'll just start off by saying, "Hi, Grandma." I mean, if a female answers, "Hi, Grandma," if a male answers, "Hi, Grandpa." And then what typically happens is then we give information without knowing it. "Hi, Sally." "Hi, Susie."
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
And so we're tricked into giving out that name of that grandkid without realizing it. And then they proceed on, you know, with the scam. Because, again, emotions. A grandparent has such a love for that grandkid. And then because the reason it's called the emergency scam, as well as the grandparent, is because they're always in some sort of emergency. The grandchild has either had a car accident, or they are out of the state or out of the country, and they've gotten themselves into some sort of trouble. A lot of times we hear, you know, "I was with some friends and they, we got pulled over and there were drugs in the car. They weren't mine, but we're being detained." And a lot of times they choose the country of Mexico. And so I have, there's a police here or there's a lawyer here and they want to talk to you. And that way the grandkid is getting off the phone. And that way there's not that voice recognition. They get somebody else on the phone and they can get that away. So now they've got that grandparent upset and they're, you know what I mean? And, "Oh my gosh, I got to help my grandkid."
Yes.
They, at some point they say, "But do me a favor, Grandma, Grandpa, don't tell my mom, don't tell my dad." You know what I mean? And then that's how that starts.
Yeah.
A lot of times they do this later in the evening because they're hoping they don't call and ask mom or dad, you know, "Where's Billy, Bobby? Are they at home?" They're hoping to get them to get that payment right over the phone now, before they're able to ask anybody. With social media, of course, we all love social media, but it also can be to our detriment because we put too much information out there.
Right.
So the scam artist might have already gone on social media and got information to help us with this scam or help them with that scam because they already have some information that they're able to then get them to believe it really is who they are. And I've had people call me and say, "You know what? I think of myself as a very smart person, but oh my goodness, I almost fell for this because it sounded so real." And they, and the gentleman even said, "It didn't even sound like my granddaughter, but yet I almost fell for it."
I
knew where she was. I knew she wasn't. It was for this one, she was out west and in a car accident. He goes, "I knew she wasn't out west, but yet I kept falling for it. I was so close to giving them the gift cards that they were asking for." So, and he called me just to say, "I can't believe I almost fell for it. Please do something to get the word out. Please help others. I don't want someone else to get this phone call. I came so close and I can't believe it because I really didn't think I ever would fall for it." And he was just so adamant about it. And I said, "Absolutely." So I put it out in the newspaper that week. And all my talks, when I go out and do presentations, we talk about it. In fact, there's a great video that one of our BBBs put together to reenact how it goes down, what they say, just to really put in perspective how easy the scammers sort of, they control the conversation and how easily they do it. And they, and like they get the supposed grandkid off the phone, you know, so that you don't have that voice recognition. But they do. They control the conversation. They know what they're doing.
Well,
and
we,
that's the sad part of it.
We can't control whether we get that call, but we can control how we respond to it. So what is the right response if we get that call?
So if we're so in tune to, you know, like when we get asked a question, a yes, no question, we say yes, no right away and without thinking of it. And we're also in tune to, "Hi, Grandma."
We're
so in tune to saying, "Hi, Sally," you know, but by not responding with their name would be the best thing if we can. But if we go ahead and we say that, but then we catch it, we catch ourselves. So when that little voice in our back of our head starts saying, "This doesn't seem right, this doesn't seem right," especially if the person on the other end of the phone is saying, "Don't tell mom, don't tell dad," asking them questions, you know, about, well, are you with, you know, your brother Tim, especially if they don't have a brother Tim.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Asking them questions that don't make sense, that doesn't make sense, so that you know then it's not really your grandson. So if you have a grandson but you don't have a granddaughter, ask about their sister.
Yeah.
You know, you want to ask something that's going to catch them up so that they, what, no matter what answer they give you, you know it's false.
Mm-hmm.
Then that way you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that your child is fine or your grandchild is fine.
Well, isn't that being just as smart right back at them? That is brilliant.
Right. And that's really all it is you're just verifying, because if you start saying, I think you're a scammer, they're already
set up.
Know how to respond to you. So
yeah.
That you don't want to do that.
Okay.
Because they're ready. They're ready of how to respond to you. So you just want to be, you know, asking them something to catch them up. And as soon as they answer wrong, you know, it's not your child.
Yeah.
And the one thing
then is, do you just hang up at that point?
Yes,
just
absolutely.
Hang up.
Absolutely. And as soon as you hang up, to make yourself feel even better, you call that grandchild or you call your daughter or your son.
Yes.
And just hear their voice.
Yes.
And as soon as you hear your voice and they say, no, I'm fine.
Yeah.
Then you can take that deep breath and say, darn those scammers.
Yes. but at least feeling good and peace of mind knowing that they didn't fool you.
Absolutely.
You have some steps in our closing minutes here. You've got some steps on what we can do, like a top 10 of how to protect ourselves.
Yep.
All right. We are so all ears.
Okay. So one thing with all scams, they're either going for your personal information or they're trying to get your money. So the ways that scammers try to get your money, they're either asking through a gift card or wire transfers, because those forms of payment, there's no way to track that money.
Wow.
So legitimate businesses will accept check, obviously credit card, debit cards, cash.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's leave cash out of it, but let's go those other routes.
Yeah.
Check, credit card. Those are your normal forms of payment. So when someone's asking for an abnormal form of payment, that is a big red flag.
Okay.
So when they're saying a gift card and wire transfer, that's a red flag. Start slowing things down. That's another thing. When someone is pushing you to decide right now,
mm-hmm.
right now, I need to know right now, we need to do this on the phone right now, that's when you halt everything.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a, you know what, I don't do anything on the phone. Can you send that to me in writing? I need to call and talk to somebody. I need to run this by, you can name anybody you want. Nothing needs to be done right now. So anytime you're being pressured into doing something immediately, to act right now, that's another big red flag.
And that's totally reasonable to ask for a little time. That's totally reasonable.
Absolutely. So then you use that time
mm-hmm.
to run the scenario by somebody else. And if you don't have the neighbor, the friend, the family member that you want to, use us. Call the BBB.
Perfect.
We get these calls every day. And so we've probably already heard this. And if not, that's what my job is, to
mm-hmm.
Research it and find out about it. Or I'll just talk it through and we'll look for those red flags and those warning signs. You don't want to believe everything you see. Like I've already talked about, they can make up a website to look like it's real when it's not. You don't want to believe the phone. I can call you and say that I'm the mayor of some country and I'm sending you money. You don't know who I am.
Right.
So anytime you get an unsolicited phone call, an unsolicited email, unsolicited letter, you didn't ask for that form of communication.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't trust that's really coming from who they say it is.
Unsolicited,
so you always
being
want to verify
the,
it.
Okay.
You didn't ask for it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you didn't ask for that piece of paper, that email or that phone call, you need to verify it.
Yes.
And you never verify by the way that person is telling you. If they say, and, you know, check us out, call this number.
Yeah.
Do not call that number.
That's not the
right
number.
So you want to look elsewhere for it. And again, you can always call us and we'll help you with that.
Perfect. Yes. Great.
So those are like the main ways. And then there's always, if you go to BBB.org, our website, there's so much stuff there. It's not just a checkup on those businesses before you do work with a company, but we have all of the stuff there to help consumers with the scammers. The tips that I'm talking about right now, you can find that at BBB.org.
Awesome.
You know, all kinds of things about scams or the latest articles. We do scam tips. I do an article every week. We post those on our website. But there's just always, there's all kinds of helpful tips
good.
We do there.
So. Well, nobody's doing a lot of traveling these days, but is there something we can do when we're traveling to be really on the lookout? I'll tell you a real quick story. We were, my husband and I were standing at a one of those little kiosks saying, you are here, here's where you're going. And a woman came up to us and said, oh my gosh, where are we here? And we laughingly said, we don't know. We don't know where we are. And she walked away. And then a man came up soon afterwards and said, here, let me help you find where you're going. And we were like, no, we're okay now. We're fine. And we walked away. And then we got this chill going down our spine saying, I think they were working together. Who knows where they would have led us off to. We really could have been in danger. That was very, very scary. So when you're traveling, is there something like in the last few seconds, closing seconds here, any rule of thumb for when you're traveling to stay safe and keep from falling for a short con or a long con?
Really, I would say doing research before you go, knowing in advance kind of like where you're staying and having all that research done prior to going so that you're not doing that last minute searching. But sometimes that happens. So just kind of being aware of your surroundings and everything. If you do it prior to, then you can always ask for recommendations from families and friends. Because there are a lot of scams out there now with travel.
Yeah.
In fact, there's a lot of rental scams where you rent something online, sight unseen, and when you arrive, it's not there.
Oh, man. We've seen hilarious movies made from those kinds of scenarios. But
right. And unfortunately, it's real. Yeah. It happens a lot.
Yeah.
So it's research, research, research.
Good
and
word.
Then asking other people that have actually been there and seen it. To make sure that it really exists, because we've had, it was someone at the BBB that it actually almost happened to. I forget how they ended up finding out that it really was a con and they ended up getting out of it. But research times three is really what it is. And then, like you said, your gut feeling, always listen to your gut. I say that probably five times a day, always listen to your gut.
Great, great advice. And I have to tell you, Kim, it is a little reassuring knowing that people who work for the BBB, for you to say there's someone here that almost fell for that, makes us feel not quite so naive. So thank you for that.
And it is. Yep.
Thank you so much for that and for the great advice. And again, just go to BBB.org. Kim Thompson, thanks for all you do in our community.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a great day.